Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Special Governance and Priority Committee meeting.
For the first time in 7 years.
So let me stop you two. Good morning, everyone. I'd call this meeting to order. You have an agenda here in front of you. So with that, I don't think there's any additions or deletions to the agenda. Could I please have a motion to approve?
So moved.
All those in favor, opposed, carried. Thank you. The first item is a presentation on the Customer Service Action Plan. I believe, Council, you have been given some documentation for it. Now, I have Katie's name on this, but I know that Allison Meyer has been the lead on this. So Allison, are you the, you are the lead?
I am the president, yes.
Thank you. Because I've been here for a long time, but others haven't. If we could have your introduction, where you normally live and what you're doing right now?
Sure. I normally live in the Planning and Development Department as the Assistant Director to the Development Services Division, but I've been seconded for 18 months to work on the Customer Service Initiative. So that's why I'm here with you today.
Thank you and welcome, Allison.
Do you want me to lead off?
Dive in.
Great.
Go tread where angels fear to walk.
So good morning. I'm really pleased to be here this morning presenting the Customer Service Action Plan to you. The format of today's presentation will begin with a bit of the background. Then I'll get into the issues and analysis that went into the development of the action plan. Then I'll review some of the key initiatives contained in the plan and then conclude with the implementation. So to begin, I'll start with the background. The catalyst for the Customer Service Action Plan flowed out of the 2011 Corporate Strategic Plan. This document contained a mission statement with the following words. We deliver high-quality services that are critical to the well-being of Victorians. There's also service principles in this document, which contain statements such as, we strive to deliver high-quality services and excellent value for your tax dollars, and we go the distance to provide easy access to information and services. The civic engagement strategy also prompted the creation of the Customer Service Action Plan, with recommendations such as, create easier personal telephone access to city services, and review customer service processes to identify opportunities for improvement. Now, part of the catalyst for the action plan comes from the benefits that will come from once it's implemented, and some of those benefits relate to our customers. I'm going to be talking quite a bit about our customers in this presentation. And so, on the one hand, we have customers at the City of Victoria who are really, they're a captive customer base. They don't have a lot of choice in who delivers the services. So residents in the city, visitors, people who happen to just come into town to work each day, they don't have a choice in who maintains the roads, who collects the taxes, who tidies up the parks each day. So it can be argued that we have an obligation to deliver good quality services using the best mechanisms possible because these customers don't have a choice. But on the other hand, we have developers and business owners who have a great deal of choice where they invest their time and resources. There's a number of really viable locations on southern Vancouver Island that are vying for the commitment of these developers and investors. So the city needs to make sure that we maintain a competitive edge, that we're attractive to business and development interests to come to our community. We also, in terms of part of the catalyst or the benefit for developing the Customer Service Action Plan, relates to our employees. If we can make sure that our employees feel connected with our customers, they're naturally going to be more involved or motivated to deliver high-quality services, to be efficient, to be effective, and in a sense, it will create a bit of an upward spiral of continuous improvement, efficiencies, and excellence in service delivery. So these benefits form part of the catalyst or reason for developing an action plan related to customer service in the first place. Now, I'll just get through a bit of the background research. I'll review some surveys, staff consultation, literature and best practice review, and some focus group information. In 2010, the City commissioned Ipsos Reid to conduct a citizen and business survey. And overall, respondents felt that the City did a pretty good job. 80% of respondents felt that staff were courteous, helpful, knowledgeable, and timely in their delivery of service. Additionally, in 2010 in the fall, we conducted an exit survey where we just talked to customers as they were leaving City Hall and asked them a bit about their experience. And again, the city got a good rating. They felt, respondents felt that staff were pleasant and helpful. But it's great that we got this positive feedback, but it's important to remember that both of these survey instruments are quite general. They talked about the overall experience of customers, not the specific area of business where the customer was looking for service. So another part of the background that I'll review with you is the staff consultation. The reason we did this is we really wanted to engage the staff, both in the day-to-day delivery of customer service, but also in the action plan overall. We wanted staff to have a sense of ownership over the action plan and in delivering customer service. So in the spring and summer of last year, we consulted 49 different staff groups and asked them questions like, who are our customers? What are some examples of great customer service? And what would you like citizens and customers to be saying about the service they receive from you and your team? During this outreach effort, we contacted about 450 different staff people. So we hit quite a broad section of our employee base. And there were definitely themes that emerged. Of the groups that we talked to, 29 felt that an important attribute of customer service was being timely and delivering prompt service. 25 groups felt it was important that there wasn't a bureaucratic shuffle, so we didn't bounce customers from one staff person to another. 27 groups talked about the need to be responsible to action items and follow up. 41 of the 49 groups felt it was really important that we were courteous, polite, friendly, and we offered respectful service. 35 groups noted the need to be accurate, knowledgeable, correct, and also consistent and fair, that if we provided a service for one customer or interpreted a bylaw in one way, we needed to consistently carry on doing that. 32 groups felt it was important to connect with the customers, to show empathy, to show human kindness. 23 groups talked about really listening, paying attention to what the customers were saying. 20 wanted to offer good value for tax dollars. 31 of the 49 groups talked about going above and beyond, delivering the extra mile, going above the call of duty. And 24 groups talked about where they acknowledged that we were also in a regulatory business, so we needed to be able to explain the rationale behind policies and procedures, and that we needed to be able to deal with difficult situations. Now, concurrent with the staff consultation, we were conducting some literature review and best practice research. So looking at what other municipalities were doing, what senior levels of government were doing, as well as the private sector. And in undertaking this work, there's one organization's name that comes up again and again. It's the Citizen-Centered Service Network. This organization focuses on researching and advancing the best practices for service delivery in the public sector. And they annually or biannually, they conduct a very extensive survey where they compile the results of about 2,900 Canadians and determine what are the factors that impact people's perception of customer service. And what they've concluded is that the five factors that have the greatest impact on customers' sense of whether they had a good interaction or not are timeliness, so whether you were dealt with quickly, whether services were streamlined, whether you had a sense that you were being passed from staff person to staff person, a sense of whether your people you were dealing with were knowledgeable and competent, the ease of the transaction, whether it was marked by courteous interactions in an easy environment where it was easy to access information, whether you felt you had a fair, equitable treatment in the process, and finally outcome. Now these are ranked in order, so even if you don't get the outcome you hope to achieve, if you were dealt with in a timely way by courteous staff who were knowledgeable and you felt like you were treated fairly, you still may say that you had a really good positive experience, even though you didn't get the outcome you wanted. Now, what I find really wonderful is that when you overlay what an esteemed organization has to say about customer service in the public sector with what our own staff had to say, there's a huge amount of consistency. I'm not sure if you can see the red. Can you see that red color? It's a bit washed out here. But there's overlay or the themes in almost all of the areas except for three. And the three that there wasn't a direct correlation relate to connecting with the customer, showing human kindness, offering value for tax dollars, and going that extra mile. So even with these are wonderful features, and it's an incredible strength for us to be building on. And the final bit of background I'll cover is a couple of, focus groups. focus groups. We did two focus groups in January, and these were pulled together using a random selection methodology, and they were fairly equally balanced between gender, neighborhood, and age. And the results from these two groups really confirmed what we'd already learned through our other research and consultation. So we didn't find out a huge amount of new information, but we confirmed the other pieces that we'd already found. Overall, the folks who attended the focus groups, they were pretty satisfied. They noted that they'd had good interactions with staff, but at times there were some inconsistencies. And sometimes they had difficulty really understanding our information and processes. And they felt that there were a lot of hoops. On one hand, they accepted and appreciated the rigor that could come with the regulatory environment. But sometimes they were just left scratching their heads, but is that really necessary? So they felt that was something that we needed to address to make our processes and procedures and bylaws simpler where possible. Overall, what they want services to be simple. They want to have a highly interactive website where they can register online, pay online. They can do this from the convenience of their home at the hour they choose to do their business. But at the same time, they want to be able to reach a live body if they want to get in touch with somebody. They want to know that when they call the public works yard or the parks yard or city hall, that staff will be responsive and attentive. And unanimously, the people in these groups, they hated phone trees. Not a surprise there. So now I'll get into some of the issues and analysis or challenges and opportunities that went into developing the plan. So the four areas that I'll highlight are defining the term customer, talking a bit about the distinction between the public and private sector, reviewing some unique challenges and opportunities related to serving the business and development community, and finally talking about resources. So, in terms of defining the term customer, in the public sector, defining customer is more complicated than in the private sector. In any interaction, we have the immediate customer that can be seen. But at the same time, whether that person is a person going for a swim at the pool, or somebody who's having their garbage collected, or if they're applying for a sign permit, in any interaction, there are also a number of hidden customers, the competitors, the neighbors, or the general taxpaying populace. So if you look at the example of a developer seeking a rezoning, they are likely interested in an expedited process and having a low rezoning application fee. But there's other customers and competitors as well who may also have applications in the queue that they want processed. And then there are the neighbors who are likely more concerned that the rezoning proposal fits in their neighborhood. And they're also likely concerned that they have a say in the process. And then there's the broader community who have yet another set of interests. For instance, they might have wanted expanded tax base or opportunities for more jobs in the region. And in any interaction, it may appear that there's just one staff person involved, but when you look closer, there's other staff feeding information to the frontline staff that's critical in our ability to serve the customer in the first place. And there's internal focus departments such as IT, HR, finance, legislative services, and communication that are critical to our ability to serve customers overall. And then, of course, there's council. Staff offers customer service and serves council, but at the same time, council is important in the service delivery as well. So when we talk about customer service, it's not just external customer service. It's also internal customer service. If we don't have excellent internal customer service, we simply don't have the foundation to offer excellent external customer service. So at a first glance, you might, you know, just see this relationship here and tend to think about this customer and this city staff person that's involved in the interaction. But really, in our definition that we use in the action plan, again, you can sort of see the red lines here. Things are a bit washed out because of the light. We're all in this together, and the action plan takes into consideration all of these definitions of customer and all of the relationships. So now in terms of issues and analysis, I'm going to talk a bit about the public versus the private sector. Customer service needs to be different in a government setting. The city cannot offer freebies to make up for inconveniences. It must ensure fairness and consistency across the board. A considerable amount of work undertaken by the city is of a regulatory nature, so it's important that we have the skills and ability to deliver messages that may not be exactly easy for some of our customers to hear. There's the old adage, the customer is always right, but it doesn't really work in a local government setting. What may be more fitting is the customer may not always be right, but they are always the customer, regardless of the situation. And so the Customer Service Action Plan, it helps establish expectations and norms, as well as specialized training to help staff in the delivery of services, especially those services that are not always going to please all of our customers. So now a bit about the unique challenges for our development and business communities. Because of Victoria's rich history and valued natural amenities, we have unique development challenges and opportunities that simply don't exist in less developed communities. Some of the unique attributes that make development and investment more appealing in Victoria also at times make doing business trickier. For instance, we have a compact built environment, so a lot of times we have development sites that have buildings right around it, right built to the property line or very close to the property line. So when redevelopment comes along, the builders need to make sure that they adhere to the BC Building Code with the stricter regulations that when you're dealing with those close proximities. As well, we need to make sure that buildings fit within their existing context, that they're built in a sympathetic manner. We have construction and site constraints related to existing underground infrastructure. So it's not as simple as just digging a trench in the ground and putting in the services to match up exactly where you want them. You need to fit into this web of infrastructure that we already have. And when you rip up our roads or our sidewalks, you'll see that the infrastructure under there is incredibly tight and complex. There's all sorts of conduits and ducts for TELUS and hydro and fiber optic cables and sewers and whatnot, which make development more challenging. We have 526 heritage designated buildings and 402 heritage registered buildings. This is a great heritage asset, but again, when we redevelop an area, we need to make sure that it fits within the local context. Because of the city's rich history, industrial land uses have occurred on many sites in the past. So when redevelopment occurs, developers need to take into account the provincial contaminated sites regulations and make sure they abide by that. We have a prized urban forest, and we're a city of established residential neighborhoods with very involved community associations dedicated to ensuring the ongoing vibrancy and health of their neighborhoods. We have approximately 25 kilometers of shoreline, which is a wonderful community amenity, but if you're going to develop near the waterfront, this means that there are numerous layers of senior government legislation that must be abided by. And we have significant public views to and from several landmark sites that are symbolic of Victoria, our province's capital city, that deserve to be protected and enriched. So some of our value characteristics, they become a double-edged sword. On the one hand, they represent what people love about Victoria and what draws them to live and invest here in the first place, but it can make doing business a bit more challenging. So obviously, developing in this setting is more of a nuanced endeavor than developing in a municipality that's characterized by greenfield development. Now, regardless of everything I just said, there still are opportunities for improvement in terms of how we offer services to the development and business industry, such as establishing a purpose-designed development center, taking a harmonized approach to offering services so that we're not hitting up developers with late information partway through the process, and overall improving our business processes. I'm not going to get into the details right at this moment, but I will in a moment when I talk about the key initiatives. And the final piece related to the issues and analysis relates to resources. Of course, resources are limited, and so we need to ensure there's a balance with regard to the services we offer. Anytime we spend time or resources with one customer, it means there's something else or somebody else that's not getting attention. So one way to maximize our resources is to ensure that we have an engaged staff and that we empower them to develop innovative processes that make the best use of technology. The action plan begins to set the stage for that to happen and lays the foundation for a more engaged workforce. And taking a broader view of the issue of resources, in developing the action plan, we really explored the full range of action possibilities, and this was not an easy task. It was very challenging. We prioritized the ones with the greatest benefit to the broadest section of the community, and we also at the same time tried to advance those that would advance the economic development strategy. And in coming up with the action plan, we went the next step. We didn't just stop at, oh, here are the top 10 or the top 40. We really rolled up our sleeves and looked at, well, what is it going to take to actually mobilize this, to get this on the ground? And so we had to determine what resources and what people would be needed for each action, and then make sure that we could implement the plan from there. So in terms of the key initiatives, there are three key goal areas in the plan, and I'll talk about the key initiatives under each one. The first is maximize our customers' ability to access information and services. The second goal is design city business processes with the customer in mind. And third is foster a customer-focused organization. So the first goal area, maximize our customers' ability to access information and services. We recognize that currently there are some challenges in this area. However, we do feel like we're making some inroads here. Recently, as you know, the website has been relaunched, and Katie will follow some stats on that in a little bit. But already, this has made a huge improvement for both our internal customers as well as our external customers in terms of their ability to access information and services. But we know we can't remain static. We need to continue to improve. We also need to develop the intranet so that both council and staff have an easier time with that bouncing back and forth of information and accessing our internal documents. And we know that we need to make strategic investments in IT. We're falling behind, not only the private sector, but the public sector as well. So we'll be prioritizing development of applications and services that enable customers to do things like pay for parking with their cell phone, book building permit inspections online, and register for recreation programs. This type of focus, it will help customers in that it'll save them a trip, and it greatly enhances the convenience of doing business with City Hall or the city in general. And over time, it also can free up our staff resources so that we can redeploy them in other areas. Another key aspect of improving access to information and services is the renovation of City Hall. I provided council with an update on that in February of this year, and just to recap, what's happening with the renovation is we're addressing some seismic issues, and we're also addressing some physical accessibility issues so that regardless of your mobility abilities, you can get around City Hall. And of course, the time to introduce customer service improvements to the physical plant, the best time to do it is when you have the space ripped up already. So when we put City Hall back together in a more seismically safe way and in a more physically accessible way, we will be introducing a development center on the second floor so that we can offer a more honoring, respectful location for our people interested in development to come to, whether it's the developer wanting to develop, or a business person wanting to get a business license, or a community association wanting to get involved in the approval process. So this is a conceptual picture of what that center may look like from the customer's perspective. And then here's another conceptual drawing looking back as a staff person out over the counter into the customer area. And you'll see in the back here, we'll also be including breakout rooms so that we have a place to take customers easily when we're dealing with sensitive or confidential information. One of the things I regret is that I don't think anybody got a picture of the second floor counter before we shut it down, and just to see how congested and crazy it was. So I can't do it before and after, but hindsight is 20/20. The next goal area that I'll review is designing city business processes with the customer in mind. Many of our processes and bylaws have evolved over time, and they weren't necessarily designed with the customer's needs at the forefront to begin with, and they certainly don't take advantage of current day technology. So what we'll be doing here, first off, is one of our first actions is we're working on redesigning the business license application process to streamline it, increase clarity, and improve the overall level of service and coordination. The potential also exists here to co-locate some business licensing staff up on the development center so that we can offer that value-added service to a customer. When they come in to apply for a business license, we can already be saying, will you be getting a sign with that? Do you want the sign bylaw? Or here, let's check what the occupancy requirements are for the building you're looking at leasing. Gosh, did you consider that you might need to have an upgrade with the washroom if you're changing from retail to restaurant? So we can start to help out our customers in that way in a better fashion. In terms of development application processes, we'll be continuing to make improvements related to building, plumbing, electrical development, and engineering permits, particularly around establishing timelines for reviewing these applications and for establishing protocols for our staff who are involved in the review process. We'll also be looking at streaming some of the application types, so some of the simpler applications like tenant improvements, demolition permits, strip outs, blasting permits. Usually these are pretty straightforward, and so we can put them through the system quicker if they're not in with all the more complicated applications. Once we get through streaming the simplest ones, then we'll be looking at perhaps doing a second wave of screening where there's less complicated but not super simple, like secondary suites or balcony additions. Another key initiative that we'll be focusing on is web mapping, and this is one that I'm particularly excited about. When we integrate web mapping capabilities into our geographic information system and make it available to external customers, we'll start to be catching up with the industry standard. And to just give you an example, 2 or 3 years ago, customers used to come to the counter on the second floor and they'd say, oh, do you have GIS web mapping? And we'd say, sorry, we don't have it. And they would leave and that would be the end of it. Now they come to the counter and they say, oh, something's broken with your GIS web mapping. I can't seem to access it today. And we say, sorry, we don't have it. And they look at staff in disbelief. And then they usually say, well, Sandwich has it, Nanaimo has it, Cowichan has it. We assure them we're working on it. But just, is it helpful just to give you a rundown of what this will help achieve? So as it is now, you can go to the city's web map and you can click on a piece of property and you can see that, oh, it's in the CA3C zone, it's in development permit area number 4. Which is fine if you're a planner and you know what that means, but for most of the people in the world, that means nothing. So then you need to know where you would find the CA3C zone, which is buried within 500 pages of the zoning bylaw and where you would find development permit area 4 regulations. What the introduction of web mapping will do is that you can click on the little icon that says CA3C and all the zoning information will come up, all the design guidelines will come up. If there's covenants or agreements that are registered on that property, those will also be displayed. So you can click on one piece of property and all the information pertaining to that piece of property will be there. Then in later phases, what really starts to get exciting is that if you're a business owner and you're wanting to research where in the city of Victoria can I locate my IKEA furniture business or Bubbles dog grooming salon, you can do a simple query that says, where can I locate my furniture business? And the web mapping can produce you a list of all the zones that would accommodate that use, and it can even then generate a map. So you would quickly have a map of all the locations in the city where you can easily go in and open up your business. So it's a very useful tool. And over time, you can put on other layers. You can add on layers of where are the protected trees, what is in that hanging basket, what are the rec facilities, how deep are the services in the ground, so that instead of having to call up a staff person in the engineering department to say, where exactly is the connection at my property line and how deep are the services, somebody could just go to the property, click, and that information will come up. And then in terms of expediting, related to the zoning bylaw improvements, to expedite the implementation of the economic development strategy, we'll be updating and revising parts of the zoning regulation bylaw pertaining to commercial zoning, especially in the downtown. And then overall, the zoning bylaw, it needs to be simplified. It's the most referenced bylaw in the city of Victoria, and like the work we did with the R1B, R1G, R2 zones a year ago, we are working to simplify it, make it into simple language, and add graphics wherever we can to illustrate concepts. And then on an ongoing basis, we'll be monitoring and revising business processes to ensure they continue to meet the needs of our customers. We've already introduced online surveys, so anytime somebody finishes a development application related to a building permit, a rezoning, a board of variance, a sidewalk cafe, after they complete the process, they're getting an email from us that ties them to a link so that they can let us know how we did, where we did well, where we didn't do so well, so we can continue to build and improve on that. And now the final goal area, fostering a customer-focused organization. This is foundational to everything we do. Staff are critical to all aspects of services we deliver, so we can't understate the importance of the strategies and actions in this section. Some of the things we'll be doing here is developing training and orientation focusing on customer service and pride of public service. We'll be enhancing communication that focuses on corporate updates and customer service success stories. We'll be establishing systems to recognize and celebrate exceptional customer service. And we know we need to do some work refining our HR processes. We'll be rebranding the city so that right up front, if you're applying for a job here, you know that we're focused on customer service. And that information about customer service, it will become part of job descriptions. So you'll see it in your job description that it's an expectation. And then annually, when you go in with your manager for a performance review, again, there'll be a discussion. Well, how did you do? Are you returning your phone calls on time? How are you at dealing with difficult situations? And then the final item under here that I'll highlight is establishing service delivery standards. So setting targets related to the timelines required for responding to phone calls, emails, and written correspondence. And then the final part of this presentation, implementation. The majority of actions described in the Customer Service Action Plan, they're administrative in nature, and we're already rolling with implementation. For instance, the renovation of City Hall that will establish the development center on the second floor, that's already started. The new website is launched. Numerous staff training initiatives are underway, and the rollout of the new service delivery standards has already begun. Improvements including streaming certain types of applications and establishing review turnaround targets for building, plumbing, electrical development, and engineering processes, that's also in progress. Customer satisfaction exit surveys, as I mentioned, have been introduced with the development applications, and they will be launched with the business license customers next month. There will be future reports for Council's consideration as we bring forward specific bylaw amendments that may be needed to improve our services. There'll be an occasional project charter that we'll be bringing forward to you for review and consideration. And then updates regarding the implementation will be provided through regular quarterly reporting. So the recommendation is that the Council receive this report for information and improve in principle the customer service action. So that's the presentation. We'd be happy to answer any questions or discussion.
Thank you. Council, questions, comments at this time? There you go.
Wow! That's really exciting. You hit about 16 different things that I was hoping that you would, and I'm just so thrilled that you've identified not just goals, but ways of getting to the goals. I have a lot of questions about process in the sense of who will ultimately be responsible for enabling each of the directions that you've identified, but I suspect that those are questions that are likely able to be better answered in a little while. So I won't spend a lot of time on that, but just a couple of things. Going back to your notion around increasing what you're calling customer access to information and processes, will, as a first step, this document be available to the public? Is it going to be on the website?
Yes.
Is it on it now? Or soon?
It would be with the agenda of the package. Yeah.
That's fantastic. And so I guess my first question will be, have you gone now into the next phase of actually mapping out which area of the city, which set of staff will actually be responsible for each of the different sections? So I'm going to assume, for example, that all the stuff around increasing access to information, which is the evolution of the website into the other areas you've identified, will essentially be enabled by the communications shop. Is that correct?
Yes, we have. That was part of the presentation where I started stuttering around because it was so complicated to do this. For each action item, each of the 45, we have identified a lead.
Fantastic.
Yes. And so each there's lead as well as all the supporting requirements and any resources that they will be needed.
I would love to see that information as well because I think it's always very heartening for everyone when they embark upon something that is this large, and it is indeed large, and this is systemic, to be able to follow through and say, you know, when we're talking about X particular activity, it's great to be able to put a face to that particular stream. So that would be great. I'd love to have that piece of information. And I guess also I'm very intrigued by two particular things seeing this. One is the massive amount of change that's going to happen in the planning department, which I have to applaud. I do agree that a lot of frustration, certainly from the customer service perspective, is just around the fact that you need to be so incredibly well-informed in order to navigate that system. So simplification is the key word, and I'm thrilled to hear that. But I guess the specific question is, when you talk about your survey responses from folks who have gone through it, and then they get this automatic questionnaire, is that also something that we can look at? Because I think that would be informative not just for the folks who are then going to analyze that and apply the different suggestions in it, but it would be informative, I think, for all of us, certainly at Council and among the senior staff, to get a sense of both what the issues are, concerns are, and the types of questions or types of suggestions that are being put forward by the folks who've actually just had the experience of navigating through the system. Not just from the perspective of looking at how you change, but from the perspective of how well we're doing in making these changes. You may be able to say, you know, today the frustrations were these, but a year from now, you know, they're completely different, or we've solved those ones. And like going back to your sense of being able to really honor the changes that we're making, it's important for us to track that and be able to give the kudos to the individuals who made it happen, but to the city as a whole, and to let the public know that these kind of changes are both coming and when they have actually succeeded, because I think that's an important part of the messaging as well. I have to just say, I have a lot of questions, but I'll save them for later or another time, as I'm sure there are other comments, but I cannot tell you how thrilled I am to see this presentation. This has answered so many of the questions that I know have been put to me about what are you doing about X, and this type of a plan, I think, has been well worth the enormous effort that you and your staff have put into it, and I'm just so excited about seeing it implemented. I think this has to be one of our most strategic priorities at every level. This has gone through a variety of different levels, not just from the perspective of customer service, but from the perspective, I think, as you started out saying, of providing the services we must provide to people who don't have any other choice. This is absolutely a priority for me, and I'm delighted to see you having completed the work to this day, and I can't wait to see it on the board. Anything we can do to help, please help. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Lisa. Just given that the room is in shape to see everybody, I'm going to start running the table and pass it out there to see that comment. So Lisa?
Yeah, just briefly, basically, I wanted to echo what Councillor Aalto said. I was particularly impressed with the analysis in this report, so thank you for that. The strategy is great, but knowing the background and particularly the kind of best practices from elsewhere, and really like that. I got up early this morning and posted the action plan to my own website with the bold headline that says City of Victoria open for business, and then tweeted and put on Facebook. So that is what I hope that this will allow us to do, and you know, for everybody who wants, from everybody who wants to renovate their bathroom to, you know, the next big development on Douglas Street and everybody in between. So thank you, and I'm excited to see this roll out. I just have one quick question. One of the things I really liked about in the report on page 4 is where you define customer versus citizen for the public sector, and you say both are equally important. And I wonder if there's any way, I'm assuming this is a final-ish draft, Goal 3 of the strategy, foster a customer-focused organization. I just wonder, given the definition of customer as this important as citizen for the various reasons, developer versus neighborhood or developer and neighborhood, if it could be something like foster a customer and citizen-focused organization. I don't want to nitpick, and I don't want us all to sit around and wordsmith this very fine action plan, but just given that you highlighted that in your report, I wondered if that could be reflected in the action plan. So thank you very much.
Jeff, any comments? Oh, sorry, Chris, any comments?
I think you're going to find a litany of thank you to Allison. I know this has been a long and sometimes tedious process, and I will admit when Allison was first given this portfolio, I had a whole bunch of people that I said, well, you should meet with Allison. And she was incredibly gracious and never said, Councillor Coleman, stop saying that. She met with all of them or chatted with all of them and said, this is the way we need to look at it, and this is the way we need to evolve and change. So at a personal level, thank you for that. I think it's absolutely the right way to go. And probably the sadness that comes out of this is the fact that we have been losing ground to some other jurisdictions in the way we deal with this process. So I think that this is fabulous. And well done.
Thank you. Any comments, Jeff?
No, it's a needed initiative. See?
Thank you. Next, here's Ben.
Yeah, I support the initiative as well. I would concur with Councillor Helps' comments. If there could be some language acknowledging that we're a city of citizens, it would be useful. I looked up on Merriam-Webster what customer says, and it says one that purchases a commodity or service. And a number of the people who come to City Hall are purchasing, and there is a monetary transaction involved, but there's also a number of interactions that the city has with entities and individuals that aren't monetary in nature. So I think having citizen in there could be valuable. One gap that I see, looks like the plan, I believe, will probably accommodate maybe 95% of the concerns that we've heard about. But I'm wondering for that 5% of scenarios, either because new conditions have arose, or because of human error, or because a system maybe wasn't optimized to the extent necessary, I wonder what consideration has gone into appeal mechanisms. And currently, council sort of, at least feels from my end, that we're sort of the avenue of appeal. And I think at some point it would be appropriate to have a discussion, is that the most effective mechanism? Or would more of a hybrid between staff and council, having a standing appeal body, perhaps our corporate services committee, perhaps a separate standalone committee? I think that's a valuable part of a customer service strategy, realizing that once in a while something will go wrong, and we should have an ordinary system in place that the public and that our customers are aware of.
Thank you. Shelley?
Allison, it's great. I'm coming from a hospitality background. It's terrific to see. I do have to, it didn't come up in the presentation. I have heard over the past 6 months some concerns that the City of Victoria is only open for business 3 days a week. That Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday are the good days that everyone can be found in planning. And I just wonder how we might be addressing that, if that is a legitimate concern that I've heard. So I think that if we're running a corporation, it should be open 5 days a week for business, and the staff and the powers that be need to be there. And I think it's something that should be looked at in this competitive business that we're in with neighboring municipalities. And my other comment would be, hospitality can sometimes simply, with 1,000 employees, can simply be defined as a smile for the neighbor or a smile for the customer, a hello. I know that the customer service initiative that the city's been embarking on has been good, but I think that that's the other, it's part of customer service is that acknowledgement and that eye-to-eye contact and the first glance or the first interaction with any staff member is an interaction with the city, and I think that needs to be broadly a focus put on that, that the staff understand that they are representing the city in everything that they do, and acknowledgement is appropriate. Thank you. It's a lot of hard work, and it's very much appreciated.
Thank you. Shirley,
thank you. Thank you for the presentation. I think it touched all the things that I thought of the customer service, just like Shelley and friends in the hospitality industry. And I've always read a lot of reports on what is customer service, so I really appreciate the presentation. And I think, as Gail said, we have to work towards not only what we do, but how we do it. And I think this will look at those issues. One of the things that I remember working in the hospitality industry is always the comment, hire for attitude, train for skills. And I think it's something that being able to support the staff and having a positive attitude, and of course with any kind of service industry, it starts from the top and has to be within the whole organization, not just certain people in each department. So I think it's important that it's ongoing, so this is not the start of customer, customer service, it's got to be ongoing constantly and how we can improve. Because I've always felt that hiring a waiter, when a waiter says I'm a good waiter, that's usually when they stop being a good waiter. It's always that achieving of I always want to be better that makes a good a good staff. And so how can I even be better at what I do? And I think it's also, Shai said, is in customer service it's that first impression, whether it's that smile at the door, but it's also the physical first impression. So when you walk into the building, the appearance of the building is warm, it's welcoming. Or is it very, when I walk into some businesses where I just feel like, I'm not comfortable being here because it's too cold and too business-like. I think we need to make sure that whoever's planning the look of the building also has to make a welcome. So it's not just staff, but it's also the improvements that we're doing as we move forward. But I think it's great. I think all the comments you received, it's not rocket science, but I think we always need to be reminded what we want as customers and as well as what the citizens want as a customer. And I think we all can talk about our best experiences and our worst experiences. But it's great. It's a good presentation, so I appreciate it.
Thank you. Pam?
Thank you. And thank you very much, Allison. I know how long this has been going on and the amount of effort that you put into it and systemically through staff as well and how thorough the process has been. And I think one of the advantages, I think in some organizations they would have brought in someone from outside to take this on. And all the way through the presentation, I just really realized or appreciated the value of having someone who had had that firsthand experience through so many aspects of the organization, because you bring that experience, but also prepared to bring a fresh eye to what could be improved. Knowing that this work has been going on and knowing what we hope the outcomes would be has been interesting in my interactions with the public, because of course you're saying, well, things are changing, but this is really the first chance for them to see how they're changing as this has been posted to the web. One of the that notion that Charlene was talking about first impressions, I know when I participated in one of the focus groups, one of the principles I thought was useful to bring to it was that for many people in the city, their first impression is their only impression. There's many people who only ever have one really significant interaction with the city outside of the development process or paying your bills. And that's where you're going to create the impression. And that's why that I think the consistency in terms of how we offer services is really important. One of the aspects that I'm really excited about is the notion of the constant improvement and feedback. Because I know we've often talked about when an application goes through and a project is built, for example, with a development application, but it's always been very difficult to find the time to say, stop, let's look, go back and say what worked and what didn't work, not only in terms of the process, but in terms of the development application, in terms of the project that it delivered as well. And I see built into this that opportunity for feedback from the applicant. I hope we'll also have feedback. Maybe it's from council and maybe it's from staff as well in terms of, is this what you expected? And being able to bring in the neighborhood, because I know informally with residents, many of us often go back, in particular to people who have been perhaps very much opposed to an application that's gone ahead. And when it's finished, if you're brave, you go and you knock on their door and they say, did this realize your fears or is it actually okay? And I think it's that ability to continue to go back and just to, you know, check the blood pressure on these kinds of things that really informs the process as well. And so I do see an aspect of that built in, and I hope we will just be able to expand upon it as part of our engagement plan as well. So thank you very much. It's an incredible body of work.
Thank you. I'm just going to make a few comments and then Gail sort of finish up. I want to say that I got one email from someone that who said, I got a parking ticket from someone, and a woman enjoyed giving it to me. She came and she smiled and she gave me that ticket, and she was just evil that she gave me this parking ticket with a smile. Then I got another email saying that I got a parking ticket, and the person didn't even smile at me. You know, it's a recognition that, as you say, sometimes some of the services we provide, people choose to decline, but they don't have that choice. But it's that recognition of both of the citizen and customer, who is the customer, not only is the person in front of us, but we have all those other citizens around that they need to have their input. Like, we serve more than one person when we have someone come to that counter, and that's really important, and that's why I counter them. And I do totally agree that having citizen and customer in there recognizes that, yes, we provide services, but most importantly, we are also a public institution. And you know, we have that higher responsibility, and that is very welcome. So great suggestion. I look forward to the addition. One thing I say is always, this is really good. And I don't want perfect to be the enemy of good. Sometimes we struggle to make something absolutely perfect. This is great. This is good. And because of the opportunity for feedback to come back and in, we have that always continuing opportunity to get better. So that's extremely important for us. I like the fact that we recognize staff as not just that person at the counter, but everyone that helps deliver that service all the way through, up to and including council. And so the responsibility for good service includes council and flows throughout everyone. Change management is difficult, and that's probably going to be one of our interesting challenges, is having people get used to this, apply it, develop the skills. But we also recognize that the mere fact that we've been thinking about this, talking about this, interacting with staff about this, asking customers about that, people are already adjusting their attitudes and adjusting their work, seeing this happen. So I think, although change management can be very difficult, I also think that it's happening and they look forward to it continuing forward. I mean, the great thing about the City of Victoria is we are open 24/7, all the time. We're picking up garbage. I mean, I love to watch them break down all the stands, all of our staff out there from the parade yesterday. There's always somebody out there, whether it be emergency services, whether it's public works getting up at midnight to get the snow off the roads so the children can go to school, to their great dismay. But you know what I mean? We're always there and out there doing things. And but I also like the fact that we have a web-based, we're using technology to really be there at 3 o'clock in the morning if we so choose to. As a service to provide that. So I'm very happy to see this move forward. It's great to see all of the work that you've done. And as we go through each and every one of these steps, we'll recognize that each one is a leap forward. But really, let's not let perfect be the enemy of good. We have got something good going here. And it signals where we want to go as a city, improving our services to our citizens, to the people that need resources from the city. Yep.
So I just wanted to say a few concluding comments. It was quite an initiative, and often when it gets down to just a thin little book, all of the work and effort and thought that went behind it isn't always so evident. There were an awful, most of the people in this room were deeply involved on a very frequent basis, and one of the things that we said is, whatever we do, it isn't just about initiatives. It's things that we hope will have a long-time implication to the city. And that's why, you know, we involved HR so that we hire the right people, we performance manage the right kinds of attitudes, that we train people, and we train people with real-life examples of work that's being done. And I guess I'd like, and so it has been a very well thought out. We also went to the extreme in terms, if we say we're going to do these things, will HR be able to do it? Will communications have enough people to do it? And so we fleshed it out right to that detail, so that, because there's nothing worse than putting something out there and not delivering, especially something so critical. I certainly have lots of kudos to both Katie and to Allison, because this has been a labor of love. It has involved an awful lot of people. We've tested this out with developers and got their feedback. Have we hit the major things that need to happen to make it successful? And I don't think I've ever seen Allison in anything but a very optimistic, enthusiastic, despite the complications and some of the issues we've had to deal with along the way. And so really great kudos to being able to pull this all together in a way that we can all understand. It was a labor of love for a lot of us. And I think one thing I learned is having all the people around the table as we discussed what we were going to do, I think it gave us all a better understanding of how the city works and how interrelated everything is. When you get down to the details, you really realize it's a pretty complicated business, and we all play a major role. So we're looking forward to reporting out to you on a quarterly basis our success as we move all these initiatives forward. So thank you, Allison. Thank you, Katie. Katie, did you want to mention the statistics from the website?
Yeah, please. Well, heal quickly, and then we'll go to Lisa to do the motion.
I was going to pull it off the website, but that's okay. We wanted to give to you just a quick update on the progress we've seen with the website itself. As you all know, we were lacking in our web presence up until a few short months ago, and it was about an 18-month process to update the current site as we have today. We did sort of what's fairly common in these cases is a soft launch once we felt we had the product ready, and that's to ensure that we didn't have any technical gaps or content gaps that we hadn't anticipated that you don't realize until you go live. So at the end of February, we launched the new site. We're experiencing about 55,000 unique visitors each month. So that's 55,000 different people each month are visiting the site. The technical and content issues have been extremely minimal and very simple to resolve. And I have to say, although we knew it was a notable improvement in terms of the site in comparison to the previous one, we've been overwhelmed with the positive feedback from both internal staff in terms of their ability to navigate and access information, but from all of our customers, those who are doing comparisons with different municipalities on how to gather information and have notably come back and said yours is by far the best, or by those customers that visit our site on a regular basis. I'm just going to pull it up.
Sure.
Yeah, if you can. Thank you. I'll keep talking. In terms of some of the analytics, we didn't have analytics on the past site. So beyond the number of visitors to the site, which is quite consistent, we didn't have a lot of additional information regarding who they were. And as you'll see in your report, we have some interesting analytics. Some of them we can't attribute to yet, but it's interesting to now be able to monitor. Mondays are consistently the most visited day of the week at the city, which I actually think is people coming to the city looking for employment. And it's a really telling stat, because when we're looking at a value-added approach to web and to everything we do, the website is very much transactional. People come, they're there for about a minute and a half, they view about two, almost three pages per visit, but they're there for a specific reason. And from a value-added perspective, you may come for one reason, but we hope that you leave with additional information, and that's something that we're trying to apply to all of our customer service improvements, with that value-added perspective. But on Mondays, we see 2,500 to 3,500 unique visitors, and that drops on the weekend. Half of the visitors to our site are from Victoria, followed by Vancouver, Toronto, the South Island, collectively, Calgary and Edmonton. 87% are from Canada, 8% from the United States. And the most popular pages continue to be those that are broad-reaching, that are transactional in nature, parking, employment, recreation, and garbage. So when we look at continuous improvement to the site, we'll be looking, how do we reach the most people with the enhancements we're introducing, and how do we get that greatest return on investment? In terms of focused improvements, we're seeing some wonderful progress in areas where they were often the most least visited sections of the site. One really good example is the focused improvement in the zoning and mapping sections of the site from a development and business perspective, where they were buried in sort of below the 200-300 level of least visited pages. Our zoning has come up to the top 25. It's almost in the top 10, and that's through the focused improvement and dedicated monitoring by dev staff in that area. And consequently, the intended result has been realized in that since the website launched, they haven't received one complaint call related to zoning and mapping information, whereas they'd received several a day prior to the new site being launched, that they couldn't find the information to begin with. In terms of content management, we now have the ability internally to update the site ourselves. We used to pay an hourly rate in 15-minute increments for every change we made to the site. So there's an absolute financial recovery aspect to this, as well as the fact that with a website, any delay in information is challenging. And there's an expectation that it's immediate, and we need that ability to be able to update as quickly as possible. And I just hope to touch on it visually so that you knew exactly what I was speaking of. We have a new translation feature on the website that we didn't have before, which I don't, if you haven't been there or if you haven't tested it out, if you can click and translate to over 40 different languages on our site, and it will translate any HTML page on the site. So it doesn't translate PDFs, but there are some limitations. In terms of the use of that, it's been translated nearly 5,000 times in the first 3 months. French, 2,300 times, Chinese, 821, Portuguese, 537, Japanese and Spanish, just shy of that. And we haven't promoted that at all, nor have we promoted the new site at all, so it's by happenstance that people are accessing that, but there's a ton of potential as we look at how we market the site and how we market Victoria to different community groups and hard-to-reach groups that have been difficult to engage with in the past, but also with other countries and other communities looking to invest here in Victoria or as we travel to other cities. Really interesting. One of the greatest consumer shifts in technology to date is the shift from moving towards mobile devices. And we knew this when we developed the site. So from a technical perspective, our previous site wasn't mobily integrated, so you couldn't pull the site up on your cell phone, whether you had a BlackBerry or an iPhone. And we designed that mobile integration into the back end when we redeveloped it. And we've already seen 9% of those visiting our site are on a mobile device. So whether that's an iPad, an iPod, a BlackBerry, but the reality is it's not really BlackBerry. So when we look at the 9% of web visitors that have been there, 81% are on an Apple product and only 1% are on a BlackBerry. And so very telling statistics for us as we look at developing apps and transactions online that are integrated with smartphones, that we're looking at the right technology that's of the greatest use to our consumer, and I think a really just telling stat overall. The I Want To section on our website, which is on the top right corner of the site, is become a one-stop. And I know that in the mayor and city manager's office, this has been a very useful tool for those who come where they're frustrated that they haven't been able to get the service or access that they're looking for. But it gives you all of our most commonly transactional requests. So I want to appear before council, I want to apply for, I want to apply for a job, apply for a permit. It's become a one-stop shop to access that, and I'll touch on that in a second. The most common referral driver to our website is Civic Info and Facebook. And we have one of the highest social followings among Canadian municipalities. We hold our own with Edmonton and Calgary. We're actually, I think, ahead of Calgary now, but just shy of Edmonton. We have over 8,000 fans or likes on our Facebook page. And we have over 3,500 on Twitter. And I have to tell you, we've taken a piloted approach to using social media at the city because we haven't had any additional resources to do it, and it's new for municipalities. So I think a lot of municipalities are going, how do we best use this as a customer service tool, or is it applicable? And I have to tell you, it has been so invaluable to us as an organization in being able to respond to citizen inquiries, requests, and also that touchstone in the community about what's happening and what are people saying. You know, we know that people are talking about the city at any given time, good or bad, but it's sort of like standing beside the water cooler and hearing what people are saying. And with regard to Facebook, I mean, Facebook is where everybody is. So if we want to go to where the people are, we go to Facebook. And when we were taking down the rail bridge, for example, the direct links off of Facebook to our website and to the Johnson Street Bridge site was enormous in terms of people coming straight to the webcam. And we see that every day. Thank you, Joel. Flip this up here. In terms of Facebook, I'll just pull it up. I think most of our city councillors and some of our staff are on Facebook. You'll often see now that when we send out any information about what might be timely or happening in the organization or in the community, that you can often link right to anything on the website or anything on our Facebook page to show you where we are. We participate in a number of conversations across the country around how to use social media effectively in a municipal setting, I think based on the success we have seen. And one of the routes we've gone at the city is to be centralized in our coordination of these tools. And that was partly out of, what we thought would work, but also just out of need, because we only have so few people with time to include this in their day-to-day work. And it has worked out really well for us. We have a number of municipalities across the country have done social media sites for all sorts of different topics. So you might have a Facebook page for recreation, you might have a Facebook page for special events. You might have one for transit or street issues or whatever it may be, and you end up with this conglomeration of tools. And what's worked really well with us is that it is that value-added piece, is that it's a balance of what's interesting and what's new. So if we have an update on something around a budget or about a participatory opportunity, that's news. But at the same time, we might be releasing 10,000 ladybugs into the community, and that is really interesting. And you see that cross-pollination of information that comes from the different things that we're doing in the community. In terms of Twitter, I think many of you are also on Twitter. This has grown over the past few years, and both of these tools were launched with high-profile issues in our community or things where we had a high participation need in the community, and it has grown exponentially. So whereas Facebook is the place where everybody is and you want to be with them, Twitter is where our community influencers are. So when we launch a Twitter account, the first people who sign up are Bill Cleverly and the team of reporters at the Times columnists. They're the CFAX on-air fellows who are doing their editorials. They're those who are socially engaged in the community and often leading organizations or leading social causes within the community. So it's really interesting for us to be able to connect with them and monitor the conversations and participate in those conversations online. What we were surprised by with Twitter is that we're really seeing it as an invaluable customer service tool. On things like parking, where I don't think that those on Twitter are actually expecting the city to respond or pay any attention to what is often a vent or a complaint, we're now able to provide an answer to their question or resolve an issue they may have. A few years ago, we had an error in our parking system that on Remembrance Day, it was just after Twitter had been launched. We had a commissioner that was incorrectly ticketing veterans in attendance at the legislature for the 11 a.m. ceremony. An absolute error and extremely unfortunate. And had we not had Twitter and saw the conversation happening, we wouldn't have been able to call that commissioner and catch that and within an hour have that corrected. Because had we not had that, I can also predict what Bill in the back may have been writing about in the newspaper the very next day. And so the immediacy of that, when we did the snow clearing this last season, been really helpful in getting that message out around having your sidewalk cleared by 10 a.m. in the morning. And so we had about a three-day snow period where we had really worked really hard to get that message out. And at the end of it, when we finally saw the thaw and things were getting back into business, we sent out a thank you. And Heather in our office, who was updating it, sat down at the end of the day, said, "Thank you, Victoria, for helping do your part," grabbed her purse, walked out to her husband in the car, hopped in, turned on the radio, and they said, "Thank you to the City of Victoria for saying thank you." And it was that immediacy of about 2 minutes between sending it and hearing it. And it's faster for us now to update Facebook and Twitter when we have like a hazmat incident a few weeks ago than it is to do anything else. So invaluable from that perspective. We've also seen a lot of great success with a new search function that actually works. We see a lot of really great stuff here with our events calendar. I don't know what this is. So as you can click onto any one of these dates, and if you click onto any of these and you'd like to attend, you can actually add it into your Outlook calendar or your Google calendar, which is really great. Integration again with however you're staying organized, and you get all of the information that you need. This is a spotlight here. I don't know what this is. A spotlight here that runs through the entire site. This can be updated and changed regularly. This is a portal, have your say, to any of our public engagement opportunities within the city. If there's an opportunity for someone to get involved, whether it's to request information, provide feedback. At times we'll have 5 or 6 open houses or workshops that are upcoming here, and it's, again, you may come out of interest or you may have heard about one thing, but we want to make sure you hear about everything that's going on. We also introduced a new vendor registration system, Times and This, which has seen great success. Any business or vendor who is registered with the city can now be sent all of our materials and calls for contracts through the site electronically, reducing time for our staff to spend on the more complicated matters. As well, it puts the contracting documents in the hand of any contractor or developer on site on their smartphone, saving hours, if not days, before they get back to their office. They can take the amendments and they can pull them up on the screen and deal with them right there. In terms of the next steps, we're really building on what we've learned in the first 3 months. We'll now be making added efforts to actively promote the new site and reach out to key stakeholders and hard to reach, which also includes our silent majority, those that we know are interacting with city services, but we don't necessarily put a face to them. And also those hard to reach in terms of language barriers, literacy, accessibility. There's some really fantastic features now on the new site that addresses that. We'll really be looking at how to identify those self-service features with the greatest customer service benefit and return for investment. Online transactions and issues related to parking, garbage, and recreation are obvious. Online registration, Allison mentioned, web mapping, as well as online consultation portals. And we'll really be, I think, building on the video aspects that are capable with this new site and which make it much more... with some of the issues facing us in the next couple of years, they're not simple issues. And sometimes a 30-second video is now cheaper to produce than it ever was before, but also can provide so much additional context that sometimes a print piece can't. And so we'll be looking at how to integrate that into the site even more so, and building on the analytics that we now have. We'll do, in the customer service reporting that we'll do quarterly, we'll continue to add monitoring of the website and our social media tools in those updates so that we can track and monitor over time. But just really pleased with the first 3 months. We have a long way to go and there are a lot of opportunity with the new site, but it's just been fantastic so far. So it's a lot to build on. Any questions?
Questions? Thank you, Kate. Thank you very much for that. One of the things that I remember Mary Nancy talking about was Calgary basically just had a day and said to all of their citizens, people, geeks out there, come into a room and make your apps. Use the material, make your application. And so rather than a city-driven initiative, that they allowed the people to do that, what they found was two things. Lots of people just got in and made applications for everything. You know, like, where are all the fire stations? Strangely, that was one of the top five. People wanted to know where the fire stations were. Various questions like that. And that they also found, and the big question came up, well, what happens if there are incorrect records of information in these apps? They're not sanctioned by the city to correct. And again, the market quickly weeds it out. Like, if someone's doing bad information, it just gets quickly dropped. So as a way to engage the citizens, for them to get out there and create applications for free that can, and you get hundreds done, and then obviously through usage, the most popular ones will rise to the top. The ones that are most accurate will rise to the top. And so it didn't take a cost on the city's behalf or staff or personnel to be engaged in doing that. So, I mean, interesting to see as it starts to go, like, I mean it nicely, like, can someone give me an app on how to get out of James Bay during, you know, the marathon? Like, something you can just touch and boom, there's the map and you've got it, right? Those sort of simple things that someone's going to think about and say, there should be an application or information on this, and somebody, some 19-year-old's going to sit down and do it for us. It's kind of cool. So that'll be an interesting thing to do, almost to do a Saturday where you go, you know, let the ideas bloom and see what comes out of it. Lisa, do you have a question?
Sure. Well, just a motion that was requested at the outset to accept the report provided to us and with staff's indulgence to approve the Customer and Citizen Service Action Plan in principle.
Motion on the table. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Council, we now need to move to go in camera on our Special Governance and Priorities Committee meeting. My understanding in talking to so many of the people around here is that there is an interest in talking about efficiencies and are reviewing. We recognize that within that conversation that there's a need for discussions that may have legal and personnel implications. And so in an effort, we're moving in camera so that we can protect the citizens of Victoria from unnecessary lawsuits, frankly. And so that is the goal. We recognize that that's something that needs to be put forward. So that's why the motion is to go in camera. I need someone to move the motion.
I'll move it with an amendment.
Move it with amendment.
Because right now, and not to be picky, but I think if we're going to do this seriously, we need to do it seriously. Right now, we're going in camera because for section L, which has discussions with municipal officers and employees respecting municipal objectives, measures, and progress reports for the purposes of preparing an annual report under section 98 of the community charter. So I don't think we're preparing an annual report today. So I just wanted to change the sections to reflect what the mayor said. So it would be 12.3C, labor relations or employee relations, and 12.3G, litigation or potential, oh no, sorry, the receipt of 12.3I, the receipt of advice subject to solicitor client privilege. Just so we're really accurate about why we're going in camera, because it's certainly not the one that's listed there.
Thank you. With that amendment, I need the motion is made. All those in favor? Opposed? Councillor Issa is opposed. Thank you. We now move into closed meeting.